It's important because it allows us to experience things, both replay of things that did occur, as well as elaborate contortions of things that didn't occur. And it allows us to experience those in the absence of fear and anxiety. In order to really think about dreams and what to do with them and how to maximize the dream experience for sake of learning and unlearning, the best way to address this is to look at the physiology of sleep, to really address what do we know concretely about sleep. So first of all, as we get sleepy, we tend to shut our eyes, and that's because there are some autonomic centers in the brain, some neurons that control closing of the eyelids when we get sleepy. And then we transition into sleep. And sleep, regardless of how long we sleep, is generally broken up into a series of 90-minute cycles, these ultradian cycles. So early in the night, these 90-minute cycles tend to be comprised more of shallow sleep and slow wave sleep. And we tend to have less so-called REM sleep, R-E-M sleep, which stands for rapid eye movement sleep. For every 90-minute cycle that we have during a night of sleep, we tend to start having more and more REM sleep. So more of that 90-minute cycle is comprised of REM sleep and less of slow wave sleep. Now, this is true regardless of whether or not you wake up in the middle of the night to use the restroom or your sleep is broken. The more sleep you're getting across the night, the more REM sleep you're going to have. And REM sleep and non-REM, as I'll refer to it, have distinctly different roles in learning and unlearning, and they are responsible for learning and unlearning of distinctly different types of information. And this has enormous implications for learning of motor skills, for unlearning of traumatic events, or for processing emotionally challenging as well as emotionally pleasing events. And as we'll see, one can actually leverage their daytime activities in order to access more slow wave sleep or non-REM sleep, as we'll call it, or more REM sleep, depending on your particular emotional and physical needs. So it's really a remarkable stage of life that we have a lot more control and power over than you might believe. So let's start by talking about slow wave sleep or non-REM sleep. So slow wave sleep is characterized by a particular pattern of brain activity in which the brain is metabolically active, but that there's these big sweeping waves of activity that include a lot of the brain. Now, the interesting thing about slow wave sleep are the neuromodulators that tend to be associated with it that are most active and least active during slow wave sleep. And here's why. To remind you, neuromodulators are these chemicals that act rather slowly, but their main role is to bias particular brain circuits to be active and other brain circuits to not be active. And they are associated, as a consequence, with certain brain functions. So in slow wave sleep, something really interesting happens. There is essentially no acetylcholine. And acetylcholine, as I just mentioned, is associated with focus. So you can think of slow wave sleep as these big sweeping waves of activity through the brain and a kind of distortion of space and time so that we're not really focusing on any one thing. REM sleep and rapid eye movement sleep, as I mentioned before, occurs throughout the night, but you're going to have more of it. A larger percentage of these 90-minute sleep cycles is going to be comprised of REM sleep as you get toward morning. REM sleep is fascinating. It was discovered in the 50s when a sleep laboratory in Chicago, the researchers observed that people's eyes were moving under their eyelids. Now, something very important that we're going to address when we talk about trauma later is that the eye movements are not just side to side. They're very erratic in all different directions. One thing that I don't think anyone, I've never heard anyone really talk about publicly is why eye movements during sleep. Right? Eyes are closed, and sometimes people's eyelids will be a little bit open and their eyes are darting around, especially in little kids. I don't suggest you do this. I'm not even sure it's ethical, but it has been done where you pull back the eyelids of a kid while they're sleeping and their eyes are kind of darting all over the place. Rapid eye movement sleep is fascinating and occurs because there are connections between the brainstem, an area called the pons, and areas of the thalamus and the top of the brainstem that are involved in generating movements in different directions, sometimes called saccades, although sometimes during rapid eye movement sleep, it's not just rapid, it's kind of a jittery side-to-side thing, and then the eyeballs kind of roll. It's really pretty creepy to look at if you see. So what's happening there is the circuitry that is involved in conscious eye movements is kind of going haywire, but it's not haywire. It's these waves of activity from the brainstem up to the so-called thalamus, which is an area that filters sensory information, and then up to the cortex. And the cortex, of course, is involved in conscious perceptions. So there's this weird stage of our life that happens more toward morning that we call REM sleep, where we're hallucinating and having these outrageous experiences in our mind, but the chemical that's associated with fear and panic and anxiety is not available to us. And that turns out to be very important. And you can imagine why that's important. It's important because it allows us to experience things, both replay of things that did occur, as well as elaborate contortions of things that didn't occur, and it allows us to experience those in the absence of fear and anxiety. So we have this incredible period of sleep in which our experience of emotionally laden events is dissociated. It's chemically blocked from us having the actual emotion, which raises, I think, the other important question, which is how to get and how to know if you're getting the appropriate amount of REM sleep and slow wave sleep. Turns out that for sake of learning new information, limiting the variation in the amount of your sleep is at least as important and perhaps more important than just getting more sleep overall. I find great relief personally in the fact that consistently getting, for me, about 6 hours or 6.5 hours is going to be more beneficial than constantly striving for 8 or 9 and finding that some nights I'm getting 5 and sometimes I'm getting 9 and varying around the mean. Now, ideally, you're getting the full complement of slow wave sleep early in night and sleep toward morning, which is REM sleep, which brings us to how to get more REM sleep. Well, there are a couple different ways, but here's how to not get more REM sleep. All right. First of all, drink a lot of fluid right before going to sleep. One of the reasons why we wake up in the middle of the night to use the bathroom is because when our bladder is full, there is a neural connection, literally a set of neurons and a nerve circuit that goes to the brainstem that wakes us up. So having a full bladder is one way to disrupt your sleep. The other one is tryptophan or anything that contains 5-HTP, which is serotonin or a precursor to serotonin. Serotonin is made from tryptophan. For some people, those supplements might work, but beware serotonin supplements at could disrupt the timing of REM sleep and slow wave sleep. Now, if you want to increase your slow wave sleep, that's interesting. There are ways to do that. One of the most powerful ways to increase slow wave sleep, the percentage of slow wave sleep, apparently without any disruption to the other components of sleep and learning, is to engage in resistance exercise. It's pretty clear that resistance exercise triggers a number of metabolic and endocrine pathways that lend themselves to release of growth hormone, which happens early in the night. And resistance exercise, therefore, can induce a greater percentage of slow wave sleep. It doesn't have to be done very close to going to bedtime. In fact, for some people, that the exercise can be disruptive for reasons I've talked about in previous episodes. But resistance exercise, unlike aerobic exercise, does seem to increase the amount of slow wave sleep, which, as we know, is involved in motor learning and the acquisition of fine detailed information, not general rules or the emotional components of experiences. Alcohol and marijuana are well known to induce states that are pseudo sleep-like, especially when people fall asleep after having consumed alcohol or THC, the active component, one of the active components in marijuana. Alcohol, THC, and most things like them, meaning things that increase serotonin or GABA, are going to disrupt the pattern of sleep. They're going to disrupt the depth. They're going to disrupt the overall sequencing of more slow wave sleep early in the night and more REM sleep later in the night. That's just the reality. Now, of course, if that's what you need in order to sleep and that's within your protocol, as I've said here before, I'm not suggesting people take anything. I'm not a medical doctor. I'm not a cop, so I'm not trying to regulate anyone's behavior. I'm just telling you what the literature says.
Thanks for watching. If you found this information helpful, be sure to like, share, and subscribe for more health and wellness tips.